Alafia. This is Nikichi Taifa, civil and human rights attorney, scholar, activist, freedom fighter, and bestseller author. Welcome to Human Rights and Justice, my new talk show featuring kick-ass commentary and stimulating guests. We discuss domestic and global themes, highlighting political, economic, and social rights. Get up and stand up with me, Nikichi Taifa, for human rights and justice.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
This is Nikichi Taifa. Welcome to the 20th episode of Human Rights and Justice, WPFW Pacifica Radio. I cannot believe that this is the 20th episode. Oh my God, we have been going strong since September, and we're now all the way in January. So I'm really excited for this episode that we're going to have. I brought back a brother who actually graced the second episode of Human Rights and Justice. When we were talking about that issue, we called it Mourn or Scorn, the Black World and Queen Elizabeth's Death. And they had Baba Obi Egbuna Jr., who is our guest today. And it's going to be a rocking, riveting show because we're going to be talking about the republication of the phenomenal book that his daddy wrote way back, first published in 1971. He has republished it with Black Classic Press in 2002, and it's called Destroy This Temple. So we're going to be hearing all about that. But first, as we do with each Human Rights and Justice episode, we're going to hear about just a little bit of Black facts. Black facts that happened this week in history, in different years. So on, let's look at January the 16th in the year 1832. What was going on, y'all? Well, Alabama General Assembly enacts a law that bars Creek and Cherokee witnesses from testifying against white people in court and criminalizes Creek and Cherokee customs, including meetings of tribal leaders. See, you know, they were doing it to the native peoples, the native indigenous people. They was doing it to our peoples. You know, I mean, I'm just saying this stuff was like non-ending. On January the 17th in the year 1834, the Alabama legislature passes a law that effectively bans any free Black person from residing in the state. January 18th, year 1771, North Carolina lawmakers vote to provide financial compensation to white owners, white folk, of enslaved Black people who are executed by the state. See, you know, they got reparations. They got reparations when their enslaved people were executed by the state. Yeah, we still ain't got our reparations yet today. January 19th, the year 1930, for 5 days, white mobs harass, beat, shoot, and destroy property of Filipino farm workers in Watsonville, California, following, oh my God, guess what? Following an interracial dancing and economic competition. January 20th in the year 1870, Southern Democrats declared the election of Mississippi Senator Hiram Revels, the first African-American senator, declares that election null and void and argue that Black people, Black folk, are ineligible to serve in Congress. The nerve. January 21st in the year 1948, U.S. Senator James Eastland of Mississippi, an ardent segregationist, successfully blocks the passage of federal anti-lynching bills. So, you know, that federal anti-lynching law was just finally passed just last year in the year 2022. Can you believe it? And then finally on January 22nd in the year 1883, U.S. Supreme Court in U.S. v. Harris limits congressional authority to criminalize racial terrorism, including violent acts by the Ku Klux Klan. So we're talking about the Supreme Court limiting the criminalization of racial terrorism. Those were Black facts from this week from Brian Stevenson's Equal Justice Institute calendar and our own Black Seeds calendar right here emanating from the DMV on January 15th, of course, the year Dr. Martin Luther King, who we call the radical Martin Luther King now, wasn't that I grew up learning about. I'm learning so many more things about Martin Luther King that you don't learn about in the history books. But he was born on the 15th in the year 1929. On the 16th, Patrice Lumumba, the Prime Minister of Congo, Africa, assassinated while resisting Belgian colonialism in the year 1961. On January 17th, Muhammad Ali, legendary boxer, was born in 1942. Paul Coffey on the 17th was born in 1759. He led the first group of formerly enslaved people, same thing, from the US to Sierra Leone to return to Africa on their own. On January the 18th, Daniel Hale Williams, heart surgery pioneer, was born in the year 1858. And on the 19th of January in the year 1976, now remember this, the U.S. Supreme Court refused to hear the case of the Wilmington 10, who had been sentenced to 200 plus years. I remember working on that case of Ben Chavis and the Wilmington 10 when I was in college. On the 20th, Amilcar Cabral, freedom fighter in Guinea-Bissau, Africa, was assassinated in 1973. And I always remember Amilcar Cabral always said, tell no lies, claim no easy victories. On the 22nd of January in the year 1793, Benjamin Banneker helps with the layout of Washington, D.C. And then finally, also on the 22nd, of January in the year 1931, Sam Cooke, the King of Soul, brilliant musician for self-determination and Black rights. He was born in 1931, and I always felt that they assassinated him, but I leave that alone. So now, Obi, my brother, I'm so glad to get to you. Let me just give you a little introduction and introduce just what we're going to be talking about. Obi Egbuna Jr. was born in London, England in the year 1969, raised here in the DMV, Chocolate City, once known as Chocolate City, also known as Washington, D.C., received his degree in political science from the University of the District of Columbia in 1992, a founding member of the Pan-African Liberation Organization, established in D.C. from 1990 to 2007. And for more than 15 years, Obi Egbuna Jr. has dedicated his life to organizing in communities around the world. He's taught African history at Roots Public Charter School since 1990. It's a historical playwright for children. I've seen your plays, my brother. Absolutely phenomenal. In addition to organizing, he's spoken around the world on the issue of Pan-Africanism. But what we're going to be dealing with today, Obi Egbuna Jr. is the son of Obi Benu Egbuna, born in 1938, a Nigerian-born novelist, playwright, political activist, known for leading the Universal Colored People's Association and being a member of the British Black Panther movement from 1968 to 1972, during the time he lived in London. And the elder Egbuna published several texts on Marxist Black Power, including Destroy This Temple, The Voice of Black Power in Britain. And that was came out in 1971. And the ABC of Black Power Thought, which came out in 1973. And the elder Egbuna's last novel, The Madness of Didi, was published in 1980, and his papers are held at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture. So, Obi Egbuna Jr., how are you, my brother?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing absolutely great. So, tell us, first of all, tell us a little bit about the book, Destroy This Temple. I know it's been noted as the first full-scale exposition of Black power thought in a British context. Tell us just a little bit more about that before we get into the my actual questions I have for you.
Okay, well, thank you. It's an honor to be here as always. But before we begin, because you were using the calendar, on Friday is the ninth year since my father made his transition to the ancestors. He made his transition to the ancestors on the 20th, the same year that Amilcar Cabral was assassinated. So he would be happy about that. And he happens to be born on July 18th, the same day Madiba Nelson Mandela was born.
Wow.
So he came into the world alongside someone who many consider personify the African spirit. And he left numerically on the day with someone who, without question, not only embraces the African fighting spirit, but takes a revolutionary approach to the African fighting spirit, Amilcar Cabral, who you mentioned. The book was the first effort to lay out and contextualize the struggle to advance Black power and the Black Panther Party in Britain. For those who have accepted the same way that colonial language was imposed on us through naked white terrorism, the same way that the seven colonial languages were imposed on us, religious and spiritual systems were imposed on us, narratives by the enemy about our own experience are imposed on us every day. So he wanted to lay out exactly what they did through labor and through service. And he was, by the time that book came out, he was no stranger to writing, because one of the things my father did is he made some significant contributions to the struggle to make our cultural and political expression synonymous, which many people consider the most difficult aspect of our struggle, because you don't want to have revolutionary culture and reactionary political expression, or vice versa. And many people don't pass that test at all. So he wanted to do that. So in the beginning of 1964, his first book is called Wind Versus Polygamy. And 2 years later, it was transcribed into a play. And it was Britain's submission to the first World in Arts Festival in Dakar, Senegal. So that's the first book.
What's the title of the book again?
Wind Versus Polygamy.
Polygamy?
Yes.
So okay, by the, I can wear it.
Yeah, wind versus polygamy.
Okay.
And then he also, by the time Destroy This Temple comes out, he had written a pamphlet for Panaf Books, which is responsible for maintaining all of Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah's publications. He did an essay called The Murder of Nigeria, which was the first condemnation of the Igbo-Biafran War, which, if people don't know, in the late 1960s, the same people, sister and brother, cousin and cousin, uncle, aunt, father, son, mother, daughter, started fighting each other in Nigeria, and it left 1 million people dead. So he felt compelled and obligated to write about that. The first person to see the manuscript of that was none other than Shirley Graham Du Bois.
Wow.
She fell in love with it, and she showed it to Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, and he was invited to spend some time with Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah in Conakry, Guinea, which by that time he was in Guinea as the co-president, where he spent the last 6 years of his life. So he felt the need to explain to people how the Panther Party came to be in London and how Black power was the complement the whole time. And he wanted to show people that Black power was not a slogan, but it was a concept rooted in the fundamentals of African resistance, nationalism, Pan-Africanism, scientific socialism. So that's what he wanted to accomplish with that book. And so it is to the struggle in Britain, it is to the struggle in Europe, what Black Power, The Politics of Liberation, penned by Kwame Ture and Charles Hamilton, War to the Movement Inside North American Borders.
Mm-hmm. So, Obi Egbuna Jr., can you just highlight for us the process in relationship to having this epic book we published? And I say epic book, and it's an epic book that a lot of folks don't know about, which is why I'm really glad that you took the initiative to bring it out again. So tell us about that process.
Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because it gives me a chance to not only celebrate my father, but to celebrate and salute my mother. My mother was the one, when my father passed on, that told me about some extended conversations they had. My father was in the at Howard University Hospital the last 57 days of his life. And so they had extensive conversations about his writing. My mom, being an educator, wanted to put out his literary work first, republish The Madness of Didi, republish The Emperor of the Sea, republish The Minister's Daughter, republish Daughters of the Sun. For those who don't know, my father, along with Ngugi wa Thiong'o, Chinua Achebe, and Wole Soyinka, played a very pivotal role in popularizing African literature on the continent, right at the same time that the Black arts movement peaked in this country, which we know was an extension of the Harlem Renaissance. So she wanted that work to come out first. So through our lawyer, our good sister and comrade, Mary Cox, she had contacted Paul Coates, our beautiful brother, the iconic, the honorable Paul Coates.
As he
said, he's glad we introduced him that way at our press conference when we launched the book, and he needs to get used to that. But he deserves that, because what Paul Coates has done with Black Classic Press is an extension of the work of Dr. Carter G. Woodson, who started the first all-African publishing company 99 years ago, Associated Publishers in 1924. So what they're doing at Black Classic Press, in our humble opinion, is an extension of that. So Mr. Coates at the time, having the busy schedule they had, the busy roster that they had, he looked at those books, all the books with a cultural and artistic leaning, and he said at this time he couldn't take that on. So, you know, mothers don't listen to their sons. So I was in Zimbabwe, and I got back in after being in the air for 26 hours. And my mother said, I talked to Paul Coates, and he's not going to publish the books. I said, you asked him about the literary books, didn't you? And she said, yeah. Did I do something wrong? I said, I'm going to show you why mothers should listen to sons. So I called Brother Paul up, told him who I was. I'd never met him up to that point. I just knew him by reputation. And he told me how sweet my mom was, how wonderful she was. And unfortunately, he said he'd get back to us, though, because there wasn't interest there. I said, she told you about the wrong book.
Wrong book.
She said, what? He said, what? I said, what she meant to tell you about was the book he wrote that captures the struggle to build and maintain the Black Panther Party and the Black Power Movement in Britain, him being a co-founder of both. Mm-hmm. And he said, what? Now, this is a Friday evening, and I'm used to flying to Africa, so I wasn't jet lagged, but I was tired. And he said, can you meet me for coffee tomorrow morning? Mm-hmm. So he was so eager that he was willing to meet me on a Saturday at 10 in the morning. And it was a thunderstorm that morning, and we spent about 3 hours together. And he said that he would publish the book. So it took 7 years to do it. Another part of the process is a consistent conversation that my dad and I, that started in 1990, 33 years ago, when I had made a decision that I was going to give my life to the people, give my life to the struggle. He said that it was important not to use his service as a backdrop. He said, because it wouldn't, not that he thought I'd do it, but it wouldn't help anyway, because most people in the United States only had quality exposure to our struggle within North American borders. So anything after that, they would consider a footnote. So he said, you're going to have to make your own way. And ultimately, I want people to accept you for what you contribute to struggle. So this is what he tells me in 1990. So around 2010, immigration, imperialist immigration and naturalization services, colonialist immigration and natural services contacted him. And they said, are you the one writing these favorable articles about Zimbabwe and that dictator Mugabe? And he said, no. And they said, it's you. It's your name. tell the truth. And he said, no, it's my son. Mm-hmm. And so I went to see him and my mom, and he said, yeah, it's time for you to start saying Junior. So it was a complete reversal of our initial conversation. Wow. And then about a month and a half ago, I went to say goodbye to a comrade of mine and a comrade of my father's as well, the great Pan-Africanist of Azania representative, Jerry Shishibe, at his funeral.
Oh, yes, Jerry
Shishibe. And I remember about 10, yeah, Nana's husband. Yeah. And I remember about 10 years ago, I saw Jerry, and he said, you know, we must never underestimate the power of the pen. That writing that your father is doing about Mugabe in Zimbabwe is breathtaking, is beautiful. Please pass that message to him and say he has the ultimate blessing for me, the ultimate praise. I said, comrade, I can't do that. And he said, why not? I said, he ain't write that. He said, but it says his name. Who wrote it? I said, I wrote that. And he said, you. And I said, yeah. Then he said, started talking about how the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. Yes. So Mr. Coates challenged me to write the introduction for the book. So I had that wasn't even in my thoughts. It was just to get it out and reintroduce it. So he challenged me to write that intro. So it took me back to a lot of valuable memories, going back to my early years, my teenage years, my high school years, and my initial service to the people. So that was the process. So it took 7 years to do. About a year and a half ago, I had started working on that intro. And after four drafts of it, and a blessing from the editor of Black Classic Press, our good sister, Camille Anderson.
Oh, yes. I remember Camille.
Yeah, the intro. Yeah, so the intro got her blessing. From there, what people will see. So you'll get a chance to see the book. And reading the book, the original book, is much more important than my intro. So, but you get a chance to see.
What a story, what a story, what a story. And it even reminds me, the Honorable Dr. Julius Garvey, I just published his father, the Honorable Marcus Garvey's book, Philosophy and Opinions with a New Introduction in the Life. So you were just following along in that tradition, and we appreciate that. But let me go into a couple of more questions, because I want to get as much in as I can. Can you, you yourself, as you know, I said in the introduction, you've been an organizer for over 30 years here in the U.S. How do you feel a book about the Black Panthers and Black power emanating from Britain will resonate with U.S.-born Africans?
Oh, once they'll get a chance, number one, to learn the true history of the Panther Party, because for people who know the history, the person who really spread the Panther Party worldwide, his full impact has never really been acknowledged. And there's a section in the book where my father talks about Kwame Ture's visit to London for the Dialectics of Liberation Conference. And my father introduced him that night. And a young Angela Davis was in the audience, amongst many others. And in the book, he says Stokely's visit was like a manna from the heavens. Uh-huh. And if you listen to the Africans in India, when they talk about the Panther Party, they say Brother Kwame was the inspiration. When you hear the Africans in Australia talk about their gravitating to that concept, they say the same thing. So, and then we know in the United States, people have a tendency to start the Panthers in Oakland, California, not New York City, which was before Oakland, and not Lowndes County.
Lowndes County, Alabama.
Which was Panther Party number one. Mm-hmm. And thanks to a brother named Mark Comfort, who many people don't mention, who introduced Brother Huey and introduced Brother Bobby to the concept, and introduce them to the history behind the Lowndes County Freedom Organization. So my father loved Kwame Ture. Kwame used to call him his big brother. And he would be happy if this book played a catalyst in making sure that Kwame gets his just due, for not only in his capacity as the honorary prime minister setting up 45 branches in North America, but spreading it to Australia, spreading it to India, and spreading it to London. And not only that, when we first started working with AZAPO, the Black Consciousness Movement of Azania, they were saying that the concept of Black consciousness as developed by Steve Biko, they said that that should never be separated from Black power. And when I got to Zimbabwe and I started working with the Southern African development publication series, which are the people who have developed the archives of all the liberation movements in Southern Africa, I read a book that they had over there that said that the Rhodesian government banned the book Black Power and banned any information about Black Power and the Black Panther, because the armed struggles in Zimbabwe and Namibia began in 1966. So I think that this coming out right now is going to expand people's horizons. And not only that, it will give people a chance to gravitate to the issues that we would consider Panther tradition. So that will be more work around defending the Cuban Revolution and fighting to get the blockade on Cuba lifted. Mm-hmm. It will be more of us will rally and make an emphatic demand that the $2 million bounty on Sister Assata Shakur's head be lifted and she be taken off the U.S. terrorist list. It will demand that the sanctions on Zimbabwe be lifted. Mm-hmm. And so all of these different issues that are considered staples of Panther tradition and staple, and also conceptually, justice, and this is no disrespect to people who have sacrificed their blood, their sweat, and their lives for us to have justice. But we know, those of us who are fighters, we know that justice is an appetizer. Power is the entree. And we are entitled to power, and that's what we're going to continue to fight for. And also the concept of party building. You mentioned Amilcar Cabral earlier. This gives us a chance to reintroduce the struggle to build the Party for the Independence of Guinea and Cape Verde. Last year was the 50th anniversary of the death of Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. So to give people a chance to learn about the struggle to build the Convention People's Party. Last year was the 100th birthday of Sékou Touré, the first political party built during the anti-colonial movement in Africa was the Democratic Party of Guinea in 1946. And that's why the Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company did the play Ready for the Revolution, which was the battle cry of the Guinean Revolution. Mm-hmm. It'll take us back to 1908 when the Africans in Cuba started the first all-African political party in the Western Hemisphere, Partido Independiente de Colo. So what this will do is it will serve as a catalyst to make us appreciate party building, appreciate striving for power, but fighting for power. And most important, and equally as important, I hear many icons in the struggle celebrated, and when people express their love for them, they say he or she spoke truth to power. Mm-hmm. In the spirit of evolution, we must go from speaking truth to power to speaking the truth about power so we can fight for power.
Speaking the truth about power, that's what I'm talking about. This is Nikichi Taifa, host of Human Rights and Justice, WPFW Pacifica Radio. And our guest is none other than Obi Egbuna Jr., the son of the great legendary icon, author, writer, revolutionary Obi Egbuna. And we're talking about the republication of his father's book, Destroy This Temple, which was written in 1971. So, Obi, you, let's see, where do I want to go from here? Your father really is considered a trailblazer in terms of using the pen to make our culture and political expression synonymous. Can you kind of elaborate on that a bit?
Well, it's what we talked about earlier. When my father got back to Nigeria in 1973, he started the first writer's workshop in Africa, in Nigeria. And he had a publication called The Hoe. And we mean the agricultural tool, just so people, yeah. Okay.
Well,
because
I had a question before about a prostitute.
And you'll find this intriguing. In that publication, he published a poetry of a poet at the time named Don Lee.
God, stop. Don L. Lee?
Yes. That's Haki Madhubuti. Yes. So when I saw him at Mary Baraka's funeral, and he said, "You look familiar," I said, do I look like the person who got your poems published in Nigeria
Woo!
In 73? So he's looking, and when I told him, he's like, oh my God. And he's like, nah, you still look the same. I say, nah, man, I was with father. And my father had passed like about 2 months before that. So I told him about it and everything. So he was very happy about that. So yeah, so like I said, you're talking about the PANAF book essay. The book you mentioned earlier, The ABC of Black Power Thought, yeah. That is a compliment to Stokely Speaks from Black Power back to Pan-Africanism, because both my father and Brother Kwame revered Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah beyond description, as you know. So the purpose of the book was to show how the Black Power generation had gone from what they espoused in terms of nationalism to getting back to traditional Pan-Africanism. And also, so books like The Ant Hill, The Minister's Daughter, these are considered like breakthroughs in the literary sense. And mm-hmm. also, I know my father would, when he would study, we have like his library. I don't know how people would take it, because my father, with some of the finest books you've ever seen, he would make notes in red ink on the back of every book. Mm-hmm. And he would summarize pages of importance and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. So growing up, because of the whole thing of cultural political expression, mm-hmm. I got a chance to learn from him why Sterling Brown is so important, why Frantz Fanon is so important. And his favorite writer of all was Alexander Pushkin, believe it or not.
Wow.
He feels that Alexander Pushkin is the finest writer in the history of the human race. Wow. And he could explain to you why, in terms of prose, in terms of punctuation, in terms of delivery, in terms of etiquette. So he was very fundamental. But then at the same time too, he felt that when you dealt with culture and political expression, lucidity was very important. He mm-hmm. said, because there are those who write about the people, and there's those who write for the people. So mm-hmm. in that regard, he felt that George Jackson's writing was exemplary.
Letters of George Jackson.
He felt that Steve Biko's writing style was exemplary, mm-hmm. and he loved himself some J.A. Rogers.
Mm.
So what he would do is he would sit me down, starting when I was a teenager, and he would read me things, and he said, now, if you can understand this, mm-hmm. that means it's for everyone. Because you're only 13.
Wow.
And he would have me explain to the best of my ability what I thought those passages meant. Mm-hmm. Almost the same way that pastors, when they facilitate Bible study, mm-hmm. talk to their parishioners and their congregants. So I had a lot of fun intellectually coming up. So when he would write, he would talk about those things. And I remember one time, one of my favorite things I used to like to do as a student in school, I love current events where you would talk about what was in the newspaper. Mm-hmm. But he got in touch with my teachers and said, I wouldn't be doing that anymore. And he said, until you teach the students how that newspaper came to be, until you can give them some history about who that author is, what their background is, and where they were educated, if you're not doing that, then you're turning an elementary classroom into a propaganda apparatus of Western media. So I didn't know what the hell he was talking about. You know what I'm saying? I'm 11. But as I got older, and then I had this crazy experience when I was in 11th grade at Coolidge, my favorite teacher. So it's the current events thing. She says, and Obi tomorrow is going to come up and talk about this madman, this dictator, Muammar Gaddafi. And he's going to explain why we had to bomb him and put him in our place. Matter of fact, this Coolidge, they don't even know who that is. Could you tell them? And at the time, I had a reputation for being the class clown. Mm-hmm. But I got up, I said, yeah, he a friend of my family. Mm-hmm. And she was like, hey, sit down. That's not funny. I said, I'm not funny. She was like, how are he a friend of your family? I said, I'm telling you, he's a friend of my family. My dad knows. So when I got home and told my father that, he was like, you what? And I said, man, what was I supposed to say? Mm-hmm. And that's when he explained to me that because of who we were, we had certain unique experiences. In the early 1970s, Muammar Gaddafi had introduced something to the Organization of African Unity, an idea for Africa to have one central media apparatus, one central television apparatus, and he was willing to bankroll. And so my father was sent to Libya, because at the time he was the director of television in the eastern region of Nigeria, in the Igbo speaking part. And he knew my dad by reputation. So they had taken my dad from the delegation, and they put my dad in his room and said, "Don't go anywhere." And he's like, "Where am I going? I've never been here before, you know." So he says, not too long after that, Gaddafi comes in smiling from ear to ear and hugs him and tells him how he followed the Black Power movement in Britain and how it inspired and just that whole atmosphere at that time. So, and we are talking about a time where, first of all, as I'm saying this, even though the book is about the struggle to build the Black Panther Party, Black Power movement in Britain, I don't want to feed the narrative that treats the 1960s like Christians treat the Garden of Eden, like it's the beginning of our struggle. So my father credited the groundwork and foundation, the milieu that was set up by the Fifth Pan-African Congress and the lasting impact that had from 1945 on. And the fact that C.L.R. James was living in London at that time. Walter Rodney was there doing his PhD. Maurice Bishop, as this year marks the 40th anniversary of his cowardly assassination.
Let me just interrupt for a moment, because I'm hoping that folk go to Google, particularly young folk who may not know who these people are, Walter Rodney, how Europe underdeveloped Africa, C.L.R. James, Black Jacobins, I forgot the other name.
Maurice Bishop, who was the Prime Minister of Grenada, who organized the most significant revolution in the Caribbean since the Haitian Revolution in 1804 and the Cuban Revolution in 1959. So what happened was he was at Gray's Inn studying so he could be a lawyer like you, a fighting lawyer, a struggling lawyer. Fela Kuti was there studying music at the time. Tony Martin, the Garveyite, was there organizing African students out of the Caribbean. So these are just some of the, and many of the member students that were able to get out of Zania, what's called South Africa today, from PAC and Azapo and ANC, they were there. So it is in that atmosphere that he grew and he evolved. And
so hold on, let me just interrupt for a moment, because I just want to make sure that the listening audience really hears what the value of this book is. And I got this from a review. Destroy This Temple, noted as the first full-scale exposition of Black Power thought in a British context. Egbuna penned this compilation of essays while jailed in London on charges of plotting to kill police officers. In doing so, he provided a personal narrative on, quote, racial attitudes amongst both white and Black people in Britain, his involvement with the Black Panther movement, his visit to America, and the profound effect on him of meetings with Elijah Muhammad, founder of the Black Muslims, a new Mexican Indian chief, and a Harlem prostitute. I want to hear that story. And his reactions to the Biafran War. Destroy This Temple was well received by radicals on both sides of the Atlantic as a seldom heard first person narrative of a Black British activist. In the United States, the book served to contrast and complement the much more noted Black Power movement. So go on. I just wanted to give a little bit more context. Go on.
Okay, yes, because he said that his trip to the United States had three highlights. You mentioned two. He got a chance to visit SNCC's headquarters in Vine City, Atlanta. He had a chance to meet with this Native American chief, but he was one of the few people who had private audience with the messenger, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And Muhammad Ali was there, and John Ali, the national secretary, was there, which means the FBI was listening in. So anyway, that comes with the territory. We don't lose sleep over that. But it raises a very important question. So this is 67. In 1966, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Kwame Ture used to tell us all the time, when he took over SNCC after they voted out John Lewis, And it wasn't because he got in good trouble either. But that's another story for another day.
Okay.
But anyway,
I'll bring you back for that one.
Yeah. But anyway, what does that tell us? We've been told, or people have attempted to propagate, brother, people who are detractors of the Nation of Islam on the question of the split with Brother Malcolm. They say that it was because the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was indifferent to nationalism. But within 2 years of Brother Malcolm's assassination by the New York Police Department, FBI, and CIA, he meets with the two young people who are the voices of Black Power, or two prominent voices in the Black Power movement. And then that's the other thing too. We wanted to use this book as an opportunity to honor and celebrate everyone who championed Black Power, be that Frederick Douglass during his day, be that Adam Clayton Powell Jr. when he said audacious Black Power, be it Kwame Ture and Mukasa Dada when they popularized it amongst their generation, be it Richard Wright, who wrote a book called Black Power in 1954, dedicated to Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, be it Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, who wrote an essay called The Specter of Black Power, where he mentions my father by name in the book, which was also another thrill of his. But the point is, so if the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was so indifferent to nationalism, so intolerant of nationalism, why would he not only meet with Kwame Ture, but promise him lifetime protection from the FOI? And why would he meet with my dad? And the reason that I think that's important is because when we talk about our anti-colonial resistance, Africans have humbly never taken credit for the role we have played in the beautification of nationalism. Before the anti-colonial movement, the Black arts movement, the Black power movement, nationalism and what Ho Chi Minh did in Vietnam, what Mao Zedong did in China, what Kim Il-sung did in North Korea, what the Irish did in Northern Ireland, as the Most Honorable Marcus Garvey used to say, Africa for the Africans and Ireland for the Irish. What colonized people did for nationalism is we rescued it, because people used to think when they thought of nationalism, they thought of Cecil Rhodes and the British South Africa Company invading the African continent with their fascist white supremacist slogan from Cape to Cairo. You thought of Adolf Hitler and the Nazi Party. You thought of Mussolini. You thought of Franco. You thought of conquerors, invaders, plunderers, rapists of land and people. Mm-hmm. But what we were able to do when we started talking about Black power in particular is we made nationalism not only appealing, but irresistible. Mm. So that is something that should never be lost. Mm-hmm. So all I'm saying is, and everyone spoke to it. Dr. King wrote an essay on Black power that most people don't even talk about. Mm-hmm. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad felt compelled and obligated to meet with my dad and Kwame Ture separately. So it definitely made its mark. So as you have people right now, some who I love, who have been treating Brother Malcolm's assassination like an Agatha Christie novel or Alfred Hitchcock movie, mm-hmm. stop it. Mm-hmm. And if you're not willing to include this, maybe you didn't know it. So another thrill I got out of making sure this book came out right now was to set the record straight on a lot of confusion that's being spread. And when it comes to spreading confusion, we don't care if it's well-intentioned or accidental, you're still spreading. If we like you, if we love you, and we respect you, we'll whisper in your ear, stop doing it. And if you've got love and respect for us, we hope you acquiesce to the humble demand.
Brother Obi, you've dropped a lot of gems here. How can people get the book, Destroy This Temple by Obi Egbuna?
They have two options. They can call our Black Classic Press and order it from them or go to the website. I think by now it may have tricked to Amazon, but you may not want Jeff Bezos to get your money. So just call Black Classic Press, or you can call your African bookstores, be it, Mahogany Books.
Mahogany and
the lead and the director or proprietor of Mahogany Books, Derek Young, is my old RA when I was a resident all director at Bowie State University. Mm-hmm. So that's my man. So if you, Haile Garima, Busboys and Poets, just call them up and order the book and all over the country. And also there's a tour being organized for the book. And we're supposed to go throughout North America, throughout the Caribbean, throughout Europe and potentially in Latin America. So for those of you who are professors that are listening to this, if you're interested in the tour, you can contact me at Obi Egbuna 15, O-B-I-E-G-B-U-N-A 15, O-B-I-E-G-B-U-N-A 15 at gmail.com. And the Twitter is at J-R-E-G-B-U-N-A. And I'll connect you with the people who are organizing the tour. So this will give me a chance to go back to England. I haven't been since I left at the age of 3. It'll give me a chance to touch down in Europe, because what we're doing is we're using this book to talk about the work that we need to do now, the work that's being done now. So I'm sure that like tomorrow, I think before the end of this week, the children of Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, we just did a video which captured our work from last year. So they, we found an old poem that Dr. Du Bois wrote about the Osage folk called Ghana Calls. So the children recited the poem. So we produced a new video. You can look for that real soon. Our play from last year that we did the play Ready for the Revolution as part of the Day of the African Child Celebration. So we had children from Eritrea and a group called Hidri perform, the children from Cuba and La Colmenita, their National Children's Theatrical Ensemble, and the children at the African children in the African community in a place called Matanzas, the art school, they perform. Some children from the DC area for the Center of Academic Excellence did some steel pan music. So people will get a chance to see that very soon. And if people want to join the Mass Emphasis Children's History and Theater Company, what we have is something on Saturdays called the Mass Emphasis Children's History, Education, and Navigational Institute. Young people from 9 through 18, we have some African history classes for them. So we have a class for children in Connecticut, another one with children all over the United States. The one in Connecticut is from 10 to 11. This is virtual. The other one is from 3 to 4. And then from 5 to 6, since January of last year, we've been teaching kids African history in Calgary and Alberta and Toronto and Vancouver and Canada. So if you would like your children to get involved in that, that's the same, the same thing is there. So once again, though, but if you're interested in the book, Destroy This Temple, you can call Black Classic Press or you can call the bookstores that you patronize on a regular basis and ask them to order the book. But if you're someone who organizes tours, if you like what you heard today, we have no problem coming to see you to spread the book, and not only spread the book, not only set the record straight, but deal with certain issues that people are either hesitant to deal with, or at this point in history, it appears in many instances, we're experiencing strategic and tactical bankruptcy. People hide behind their ideas and they're not pressured to execute them. So those of us who have a little bit of experience can play a role and pushing things forward, pushing the envelope.
Brother Obi, I have one last question in the 2 minutes that we have remaining. I just want to know, how do you feel this book will impact the Black Panther, Black Power legacy, and beyond? In terms of
Black Power, it will address the attempted hijacking and misdirection of Black Power. Because they are people who don't know the history of the Black Power movement, but because they know how that concept resonates with our people, just the way it sounds, they've exploited it for political mileage. So we'll just use that opportunity not to condemn them, not to criticize them. That's not our style. But we can use this as an opportunity to help people who are genuinely curious, genuinely hungry, genuinely open. We will retrace the steps. We're going to take it back to Frederick Douglass for them.
I just want to, because we're almost at time and I understand we have a caller on the line. So I want to see if we can bring the community in. Okay. Caller, can you let us know who you are, where you're calling from, and what your question or comment is for Obi Egbuna Jr.?
Hey, Sister Nikiki, this is Mr. Douglas. I'm from Cuba and I'm from Los Angeles.
Oh, My sister attorney, Milagros, how are you from Cuba?
I'm doing excellent, my sister, with your book writing self. I'm so proud of you.
Thank you. So do you have a question or comment, brother?
Yes. I wanted to find out, or I just wanted to let you know, I don't know how in-depth you guys have gone with Matanza. I'm from that city, first place that slaves were ever brought by the Portuguese. And I now live in Portugal. And it's my decision. So what do you think will happen once the observers are there, especially the children, as it relates to the party and a few of our colleagues who are there and have been there for years? What do you think the impact will be on them?
Did you get that question, or should rephrase it?
If you could repeat it to me. It sounded like she said the children in Cuba.
But Milagros, can you kind of rephrase that a little bit for him?
Yes, I can. I wanted to find out what impact he believes that the Cuban visit, if this is what I understand is going to happen, and that he will be going to Matanzas, which is my home.
No. What I said was, we had a festival that we organized around the 100th birthday of Sekou Touré, and we performed a play, Our Children, called Ready for the Revolution. And we had children in Matanzas at the art school. They participated. They sent us a video. So when we release the video of the program, people will be able to see them. In relationship to what you're saying about Cuba, the main thing that we're working on right now is we want to create a fund in the diaspora to finance but send material to their work on the African continent, where they have 4,000 doctors dispatched throughout Africa. We're out of time.
We got to bring this. Let me just say real quick, I just want to thank you for being my guest today. I want people to get the book. I want people to thank everyone for listening to this show. I want to thank our engineer, Deontay. And if you're listening via podcast, shout out to our Canopy Collective, who engineers this up on Spotify. And of course, you can get this episode and all others on WPFW Archives and on the Nkechi Taiyipa YouTube channel. So get up and stand up for human rights and justice.
Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up the fight.